marshal needs to go.
To visit our friend Don.
And walk out to the Navy Pier. His store is just a bunch of commercialized shops, but outside.
Welcome to the College of Complexes.
Next to me is my friend.
I was at a private party back in the 70s at that point.
Welcome to College of Complexes. This is our 328th meeting since we started in February of 2009.
Different speaker on every week, a different subject. We require our speaker to take a position on an issue or express a point of view. Everybody's babbling.
Am I in the way?
We give our speaker an hour to make a presentation. If over an hour, we cut him off. If anybody interrupts the speaker, remind the interrupter we listen only one fool at a time. That's one of our rules. Then we have questions and answers from the audience, not speeches. And then we have remarks, rebuttals. Everybody in this audience at once who gets 5 minutes at the podium here to respond to what the speaker said for or against. The speaker gets the last word, gets a comment, and close the meeting. That's how it works. But before we put on our speaker, we have announcements. So if there are any announcements, now's the time for announcements. Anybody have any announcements they want to make? Well, I got a couple here. If you live, there's a barbecue dinner and rally for Hinga supporters Thursday, August 18th, 7 to 9 p.m. Hingis is a automotive place on Ross Avenue that is being run out by eminent domain. So I'm not quite sure of the argument that's going on there, but it's not a good thing for eminent domain to take out small business and not replace it with a park or something that's public, but give it to someone else. Hingas, H-I-N-G-A-S. Here's the info on it. Anyway, I have brochures here if you're interested. Next week it's on here. It doesn't show the meeting's open, but we're going to have Karen, Kathleen, what's her name? I forgot her name. Catherine McGovern is going to be here next week. She was a delegate to the Democratic National Convention, so she's going to talk about that and what the future holds. I think that's what it'll be about. So anyway, she's supposed to give me a blurb. I don't have it yet. And when I get it, we'll put it up.
What about Hinga?
Hey, I just announced Hinga. Okay. You weren't listening. You were talking. But anyway, August 27th, the Sleeping Giant, that's Jim Love is going to talk about that. It's on meeting number 330. It's on your itinerary. I'm not going to read all this. On September 3rd, Labor Day, past, present, and future, Gene Lance. He's the president of Texas Alliance of Retired Americans. He'll talk about that. Ought to be interesting. That's on your itinerary also. Now, our speaker tonight, who is sitting right here, is Dexter Elkins. He's going to talk about how to make a more perfect world. He's a current college professor. He's a retired lieutenant in the United States Marine Corps. He will discuss how, if the primary problem of having a viable world is dysfunctional people, then what would be a solution? As a teacher, he thinks one of solution is education. However, education does not work so well. How about legislation? Have laws, justice, juries, police, etc., proven effective? Dexter will argue only partially. Laws don't change the human heart. For example, following the Civil War, slavery was abolished by law, but the South continued to racism with Jim Crow laws, discrimination, and even lynchings. But bigotry is not a democracy or justice. As what has led to America to think the color white is associated with goodness. It is such a belief that even in the text of critical thought, America and Nazi Germany have favored the Nazis' race whites over all other races in America, it led to slavery. In Germany, it led to genocide. So would a better world be colorblind? With guards, engineering, we could purify the human race. Or should we? He again, and the ID glasses, you think?
He's got glasses.
He again, and concludes the perfection is not progress. Anyway, without further ado, please give a very, very warm welcome to Dexter Elkins.
How many are going to vote for Trump? Anybody going to vote for Trump? I think we have a new candidate that's running. Some guy got on last night and said that he was the ex-head of the CIA or something?
Yeah.
Mullally,
he's running as a Republican.
Yeah, he's going to offer an alternative. He's kind of getting started late, isn't he?
Yeah.
He's not too late if Trump dies of lead poisoning.
We don't want that.
He's already threatened that for Hillary.
That's only because he received those threats first.
Yeah, he didn't talk about that. But I'm working on another degree at SMU. I started last year. And one of the, what we do in this other degree I'm working on, which I hope eventually provides me with a doctorate degree, which I quit working on 30 years ago, so I've decided to go back and try to finish up. And so I've been taking these classes at SMU in the liberal studies. And one of the things that we, first class I signed up for this time last year was the Confederate South, dealing with primarily the Civil War. And then I went with the same professor to Prague and Vienna, and we studied the concentration camps over in Austria and Czechoslovakia. So it's been an interesting period of time for me. And I got way too many books to read. Don't ever start one of these graduate programs when you get my age, because they make you read, I think we read 15 books in the Civil War class. It's still up for debate, which is what I said in that little introduction blurb, you know, that we had a war and the battles were decided, but the people that were in favor of slavery and discrimination, their hearts didn't get changed just by a battle or by legislation. So the 13th and the 14th and the 15th Amendment, the Emancipation Proclamation, did not necessarily change everybody's attitude. It just simply, you know, talked about what was legal and what was illegal. One interesting thing that I mentioned to you about the Civil War class was I did not know much about Abraham Lincoln's religious background. I knew he was raised poor, never went to school, was from a hard scrabble family in Kentucky, and they, you know, survived by the skin of their teeth. And he finally, because he had a good mind, he started reading a lot of books. He had the Bible, he read Shakespeare, and a couple of classics, and some pamphlets that were passed around. That was basically Abraham Lincoln's education. Not bad to know everything about the Bible and about Shakespeare. But as he matured over the 1840s and 50s and up until he got elected president in 1860, he became more and more convinced that religion, in his way of thinking about religion, which was not you know, a denomination. He was never a Church of Christ or a Baptist or a Methodist. But he was influenced by all those people. And they would try to get him to join a church. And he said, no, I don't want to join a church and adopt a doctrine. I just want to understand, you know, what God is and how I'm supposed to live. But what happened to him in 1862 was he began to think about, this is right in the middle of the Civil War, and in fact, the Confederates were sort of winning in 1862. And so the Republicans, he had started or joined the Republican Party, and he said, we need to figure out a way to free the slaves, but not to make it so bad on us by doing that, that we lose support here in the North, because there were a lot of racists in the North, too.
And slaves.
Huh?
And slaves.
There weren't so many slaves in the North. They had mostly been freed many years earlier, but there were a few. And their attitude towards slavery in New England, because of the influence of the Quakers, they felt it was their duty to remind the congregations that Jesus did not just die for white Baptists and white Methodists. He died for blacks, he died for Tartars. There was a long list of that Lincoln talked about, that or that Fox, Matthew Fox, talked about as a founder of the Quaker religion in 1680-something. But they said that even though people own slaves, they should respect those slaves as people that Jesus died for, and that they should teach them as much as they could about Christianity and about civilization. They should not abuse the slaves, and they should free them after a certain amount of time, 5 years, 10 years. And when they freed them, they should give them some monetary reward for the effort they had put in as slaves. So he proposed this in the 1600s originally, and he proposed it primarily to the sugar plantations, which is where the worst abuses were happening, Louisiana and Barbados in the Caribbean. And none of the people, apparently, that followed Fox and the Quaker religion, what they call the Society of Friends, actually took him up on it. They rarely changed their behavior as a result of what he had proposed. But that was the beginning of the movement, which came to be called abolition, and was picked up in the 1800s by a number of people like William Lloyd Garrison and Harriet Tubman, and Harriet Beecher Stowe, who was actually a white girl, wrote Uncle Tom's Cabin. In fact, Lincoln said when Harriet Beecher Stowe came to the White House to meet him in 1862, she walked in the door and shook hands with Lincoln, and he said, oh, so you're the lady that started the Civil War. Because her description of Simon Legree and the treatment of the slaves had affected people unlike anything that had ever been written before. It was a novel. It was a fiction. She was from Connecticut, and she was the daughter of a minister and was schooled in a private girls' school. But she did a report on sociology, so she got the train, and she went down to visit her brother in Louisiana. And while she was there, she watched a slave auction. And it's the slave auction that kind of convinced her that she should write Uncle Tom's Cabin, which I think in the 1860s was one of the best sellers worldwide. Anyway, what happened in September of that year was kind of interesting. I thought I'd mention it. Lincoln met with his cabinet about the Emancipation Proclamation. He was toying with the idea of publishing it for the country. And I don't know if you know about Lincoln, but he liked to have people that disagreed with him on his cabinet. So, and in fact, his vice president was a Confederate racist named Johnson, who he only took in as vice president because he needed the votes from that particular persuasion. But anyway, he got his cabinet together and he said on the morning of the 22nd of September, well, I'm thinking about this Emancipation Proclamation and issuing it. What do you all think? So the cabinet, almost to a man, said, you can't do that. You can't publish the Emancipation Proclamation. You can't free the slaves. It would affect our status on the battlefield. It would turn Northerners away from support. It would rejuvenate the Confederates, who are already doing pretty good on the battlefield. For a lot of different reasons, on a lot of different levels, this is not the good time to issue the proclamation, Emancipation Proclamation. So that was about 10:30, 11 o'clock in the morning. And he said, well, let's take a break for lunch and meet back here at 1 o'clock. So he went back into his chambers and was there for a couple hours by himself. Came out again, and one of the great gifts that Lincoln had that so few people have, especially politicians, was his ability to listen with empathy. Lincoln was raised as a racist. He thought that the whites were superior to blacks as a race. He did not appreciate low-class people, even though he himself had been raised that way. But he hated slavery. And he said, you know, if slavery is not wrong, nothing's wrong. We need to have this thing settled. We need to get the proclamation signed. So he's back there at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, and he asks again, does anybody think about this or have any comments they want to make? And basically the whole group said, you can't issue that proclamation. And he listened. And then he said, well, guys, I have to tell you something. I was in there by myself, and I was thinking about this because it is a critical time for our nation. And I prayed. And he said, you know, I'm not a member of a church. I've read Thomas Jefferson's Bible. Thomas Jefferson rewrote the New Testament the way he thought it should have been written. And Lincoln read that. And he said, you know, after I prayed, I was sitting there quietly, and God spoke to me. And he said, you know, I know it sounds kind of strange. I've never talked this way before, but I have to admit to you that God talked to me and said, yes, you must sign and issue the Emancipation Proclamation. So he said, I've listened to what you all say, but I haven't gone back to God for a second opinion. So I think I'm gonna go with, I think he's more important right now to listen to than the cabinet. And that was on September 22nd. They issued the proclamation shortly afterwards, and it went into effect on the 1st of January, 1863. And in fact, it had a lot of bad repercussions. Of course, it caused incredible controversy in the South because these slaves were putting their tools down and leaving the horses alone and getting out on the road and saying, hey, we're free, we're free. And many of them, I don't know what the number was, if it was either 75,000 or 100,000, but a huge number of Southern slaves left and joined in with whichever Union army they could find close by and became Union soldiers. Initially, when they joined, they were promised their freedom. But then they joined, I guess they had a union. Do y'all know about unions, Tom?
Yeah.
And the union said, well, you got to pay these guys something. You know, you're paying the white guys, you know, you got to pay the black. So they actually got minimum wage, I think. I guess back then it was probably, what, $7.25 an hour like it is now? It was probably hadn't changed much over the years.
Probably 7 cents.
So anyway, they even got uniforms and rifles and actually were eventually, I think, integrated into the white forces. They had their own black regiments and divisions and so forth, but eventually they were integrated. In fact, it was not until 100 years later in World War II that the white and black soldiers were actually, they were colorblind in the military. I think it was 1942 or 3, something like that.
Was Eisenhower,
wasn't it? Roosevelt.
Oh, was it? Oh, Roosevelt did it. Right.
Yeah. Right.
World War II.
Yeah, they were still a separate soldier group in World War I. But you know, it never Lincoln was assassinated before he could put in place his Reconstruction plan. So, who becomes president when the president's assassinated? The vice president, Southern Democrat, racist, Johnson. So that's good. One explanation for what happened to Reconstruction. Ulysses Grant tried to correct that later when he became president, but it never really had much bite to it. I think it was probably 1877 when they just quit trying to do Reconstruction. Of course, there was a lot of corruption on the, what do we Southerners call those guys from the north that came down there?
Carpetbaggers.
Scalawags. Yeah, we had names for them. My great grandfather came over from Tennessee in the 1840s and settled on a farm down by Glen Rose, Texas, which is still in the family. It's where I go on the weekend. He raised his kids down there in Hyco, Texas, in the 1840s. He came over in 1840s, I guess at 1855 that they established that farm down there between Iredale and Hyco. And he did not start the Ku Klux Klan in that area, but his son did. And I actually knew and used to visit with my great-great-grandfather. My great-great-grandfather lost an arm in the Civil War and came back from Louisiana with one arm in 1865, and he wrote an autobiography, which is, I'm real proud of the fact that one of my ancestors took time to sit down and write an autobiography of what life was like coming over from Tennessee on barges and wagons and settling a hard scrabble area like Central Texas. But my great-great-grandfather, who I did not know, the one that lost the arm, he actually was one of the founding members of the Ku Klux Klan in Hyco, Texas, which is, according to an historian at University of Texas, is still the epicenter of Klan activity in Texas. So my family has some reputation, I think, in that area.
Solid foundation.
Yeah. I was leaving the farm one day about 2 years ago, and I had to stop and ask somebody about a back road that I wanted to take. And so I just pulled up to this farm on the edge of town and saw a guy mowing his yard. And got out and asked him where this road was I was trying to find. And he said, it's, you just turn left there at that tree and you'll run right into it. You from around here? I said, well, we have a farm close by. Where do you live? I live in Dallas. Dallas? With all them niggers?
Is that a lynching tree?
Yeah, that's what, I mean, it's, started to joke about this stuff because it was such a, But I don't think it's changed. My mechanic believes that. Well, in fact, two friends of mine that are mechanics over the years will not wait on a black person that comes in. And one mechanic is as violent a racist as you can imagine. And he's a brilliant guy. It has nothing to do with intelligence. I mean, he's a mechanic, he's a problem solver, but he is a dyed-in-the-wool racist. So reason I'm mentioning this about the South and about slavery is because I wanted to talk about Germany and Hitler and the road to a utopia. Do y'all know what the word utopia means?
Yes.
You've heard it before, right?
Right.
What does it mean, Tom?
Utopia.
A perfect world, yeah. Do y'all know where that word originated? Yeah.
Thomas
But earlier than that,
the Greeks.
Yeah. Who's the most famous Greek?
Aristotle. Utopia.
Plato. Yeah. In the 4th century BC, Plato wrote a book that remains one of the most famous books in civilization, and it's called The Republic. And it's a utopia. He says this is the book of utopia. This would be the better world, the perfect world, if we could do it. The word actually in Greek means literally nowhere. So it wasn't like he thought this could actually happen, but it's like a target. We used to, in the Marine Corps, we used to shoot at targets at 500 yards, open sights, and pretty hard to hit a target like that at 500 yards. But that's what we were supposed to do from the prone and standing and sitting position. And that's a difficult target to hit, but at least it puts you in an area. That's what it's for. It's to get you into an area. So utopia, which means nowhere, it's a target out there. It's something to shoot for, even though you might not ever hit it right on the bullseye. And it's very controversial, and has always been controversial, what Plato said about the world that would be a better world. It would involve everybody in the society caring about each child as if that child were their own. But I think probably the most radical thing that Plato said was, and we need to give women the same education that men give. Now that's unheard of, right? I mean, it's still not, well, I guess there are as many women now in school as there are men.
More?
More.
More graduates.
Yeah.
College.
Right, yeah. Well, because they have sugar daddies that support them. I mean, you know, us men, we have to support ourselves to go through graduate school, but the women get a free ride, right? I don't hear any negatives. I don't hear any. Anyway, Plato had a lot of things to say about how to have a perfect society. One of the things that he said that I'm using in this paper I'm working on that concerns Hitler and the death camps is he said the people you do not want to have in power are the very people that want that power. So what you have to run a society effectively is a philosopher, someone who has no ambition for anything, just likes to ask questions and think about stuff. Like he was, you know. Yeah, sure. But he said, and I, you know, as I read these books on Hitler and on the rise of Nazism, it's just mind-boggling what happens to people that get power if that's what they want. And unfortunately, Hitler was able to, strangely enough, create an environment in Nazi Germany in the 1930s that had 60 or 65 million Germans to follow him into war against the Allies and the rest of the world. And part of his program was to, initially, when he very first started the National Socialist Party, which he didn't start alone, but he had a couple of friends. And I brought I brought his book, Mein Kampf.
Yeah.
You all heard of that book before?
Yeah, I wrote.
It's amazing for a guy. He had no education either to speak of. He's self-educated. But he wrote this 700-page book on how to make a world better. And all you have to do to make the world better is get rid of the primary problem with the world, which is what?
People.
You have to get rid of the bad people. If you only have the good people, the people that God likes, they are white, they're Aryan, they're Nordic, and everybody else is a cancer on the world. So he put all this in Mein Kampf, and nobody read it. His own Nazi party, or which at that time was called the National Socialists, he couldn't even get them to read it. I think about maybe 10 people in his group in the 1920s. He wrote it in prison. He was put in jail for a barroom brawl that he started one night because he was a rabble rouser, and so he started this conflict, you know, like the putsch that he eventually, you know, successfully took over the Nazi party at a beer hall in Munich. But this was earlier. This is 1825. So he was arrested and put in prison for about a year. And in prison with him, luckily in the same cell with Adolf Hitler, was Rudolf Hess, who was apparently a pretty smart, educated racist. And they got together, and Hitler dictated Mein Kampf for a year to Rudolf Hess. After they got out of jail in 1927, they went back to the Rothschilders and the beer halls and so forth, and just every night they'd get drunk and rabble-rouse, you know, complain about the Treaty of Versailles, complain about Hindenburg, complain about the Weimar Republic, but primarily it was about the people that stand in the way of progress. And Hitler knew then, and said in the very end of his life, that he was sent to Earth just like Plato was sent and Socrates, with a mission from God. And the mission was to restructure the world according to Aryan supremacy. That God was white, God was Aryan. And where did he get this from? Well, he got it from the Teutonic tribes that had been in Germany for 1,000 years. And so he was determined, since he was sent here by God, he thought of himself as a second coming of Jesus. He thought of himself as a Messiah. And what's strange about studying about Hitler and what he did in Germany was how in the world he was able to convince 65 million people to follow him. And they all were educated better than he was. He was ugly, he was short, he was dumpy. He had primarily one skill. It's kind of scary.
Communication.
Oratory. He says in Mein Kampf at the very introduction, he says, you know, nobody follows anything that's written, but they love to follow people that talk. We are an oral, you know, we're still an oral people rather than a written people. And so he said, I have primarily one skill. I can't get a date, so I have a lot of free time. Yeah, apparently he didn't have ever any kind of a love life. In the bunker, right before he died, he wrote a letter to the world, and he had this cousin with him, Eva Braun, and they had a suicide pact. So they took poison, I think he shot her and then he took poison. I forgot the way exactly. Does that make sense? Is that right?
The other way around.
Yeah, they both died, but he wrote this last letter, and he married her that day. The day they died is the day they got married. I don't know who married him, but his letter that he wrote was, it's only about 2 pages long. It's a suicide note. And he said, you know, I die with a happy heart. Now, this is in the bunker as the Russians and Americans were taking over Germany. I mean, he lost the war, right? But he thought, like some of the Southern Confederates, the war, the battles are over, but the war's not over yet. And he said, there's still a strong urge to get rid of all the bad people in the world. And he once again listed who all the bad people were. They're Poles. You're there. There's Poles, there's Russians, there's Communists, there's Jehovah's Witness, there's Gypsy, there's Spanish, there's Greek, and then of course the Jews. So he had a lot, and then he said, and also we need to get rid of all the people that have any disabilities. So if you're colorblind, you're dead. If you walk with a limp, or you don't hear well, I mean, almost any defect, because he went into a lot of discussion over the years as to how to round these people up and how to get rid of them. And he started in 1933 going to hospitals and finding people that were ill and having them killed by doctors. And he made, you know, he didn't do any of this on his own. He got lawyers and doctors to side with him and to write up legislation that said, we'll have a better world when we get rid of all the dead weight. And we just have to get rid of these people. He acted like he was sort of sorry that they had to. But people that are disabled, people that are epileptic, people that have any kind of defect should be either sent away. He made plans with Palestine to send crippled Jews to Palestine. His initial attempt was not to kill all the Jews, but just to get rid of them. So he had these plans. Well, he opened up, he had confiscated a few castles. We went to one this last January, and it was the castle at Hartheim, and that's where people with mental problems were sent, and people with other kinds of psychological as well as physiological disabilities. And it was designed, what he called, for therapy. He used the word therapy. Therapy was to give them medicine until they died. But it was, in his mind, it was, that's what's therapeutic. Therapeutic for whom? For the Third Reich. He identified himself as the Third Reich. He was the final judge on everything that happened in Germany for 12 years. Everything that he said, and everybody treated him like he was a god. So we went to a couple of these places, Mauthausen and Hartheim and Linz, and we went into where they did the operations, where they did the sterilizations, where they did the executions. And it started off as a kind of a medical experiment just to see how you could kill people that weren't dead yet because they were disabled. It's heartbreaking to read about some of the stories of the children that were rounded up because they were overactive. You know, what's that called now, ADH or something like that? He had all those children rounded up, and he appointed judges and doctors to classify them as unfit for life because they caused problems. They cried too much, or they couldn't learn things, or they threw up too much, or they made noise. So they were put into these hospitals or these institutions. And they were given phenol and opiates and morphine. They were given cocktails. It was initially to see how they could kill people easily. It was the first step toward the death camps and the genocide. And it got more and more barbaric. When it looked like it took too long to kill people, they had to find ways to speed up the process. Then they had the problem of killing so many people so quickly that there was a new problem. What do you do with all those dead bodies laying around? So they had to get prisoners to go into the chambers after they gassed them. And their job was to take the bodies into a ditch or to the crematorium. And they were killing, you know, 5, 10, 15,000 people a day, you know, with this process. Did y'all see the movie that came out last year?
Which one?
Son of Saul.
I did. It was the best
saw that one.
Movie I've ever seen on the Holocaust. Hungarian movie.
Yeah.
Right. Vila de Saul.
Is that the?
The Hungarian name, yeah.
Yeah. Laszlo was the director, I think.
Right.
Never had heard of him before. So unusual to see a movie like that where they didn't show a lot of bodies, you know, being picked up by bulldozers and putting into ditches and so forth. And all he's trying to do is get his son buried with a proper Jewish burial.
I don't know if that was his son, but he just wanted
he thought it, he, I think he wanted to believe it was his son. Yeah. And so he risked his life to get a burial for his son. It was a, yeah, it was one of those powerful films. But the effort in Germany at some of these camps is, has anybody ever been to a death camp?
Did you ever go to
you been to one?
Dachau.
Which one did you go to?
Dachau.
Dachau, yeah. Yeah, we had Dachau, Mauthausen, Hartheim, and Lidice. By the way, there is a there's a movie coming out this week. Where did I put that? There's a movie coming out this week about a town, about a man who wiped out an entire town. The you know some of the names of the Germans. You know Hitler's name, Himmler, Goebbels, Eichmann. So we know some of these names that are kind of popular. But I did not know who was considered to be the most evil man in Germany by the Germans. Heydrich? Reinhold Heydrich was sort of a bureaucrat that Hitler kept moving up the ladder in terms of power. And he was given the head of the Gestapo in Poland, and he was so cruel and was so efficient because he worked it like a bureaucrat without any remorse and without any emotion. So this movie that's coming out is a true story of the attempted assassination of Heydrich by the British and the Czechs and the Russians. They got together in 43, I think it was, late 42, early 43, and they decided that they had to assassinate Heydrich. So they got two Czech commandos, two Russian commandos, some British commandos, and they sent them all to England to train for 2 or 3 months on a plan to assassinate Heydrich. And that's what this movie is about, called Anthropoid. And it's I haven't seen it yet because I think it's being released either today or next Friday or sometime, right this week about, sometime this week. But Heydrich had a palace he lived in, and then he went to work in Berlin, no, Prague. His office was in Prague, so he had to drive daily to his office. Well, of course, he had, you know, a convoy. He had people that drove with him. He had bodyguards. But this plan was set in motion to have seven of these commandos parachute into Prague, and they had contacts with the Czech resistance, and they were going to work their way down to this area called Lidice, a little village, because that's where he drove by on the way to work. And so one soldier was trained in assassination with a rifle. Another was trained on hand grenades, and this had to go off like clockwork. So it was, because he had to make this, Heydrich had to make a turn on this road, and he had to slow down to make this turn. And so he could only go like 15 or 20 miles an hour on this one sharp curve. So they positioned one commando at a tree to shoot him when he came by, and then another one to throw a hand grenade into the open convertible Mercedes he was driving in. Anyway, these seven commandos parachuted in, and I think two of them died. Oh, you want to hear the ending too? Want me to spoil it and tell you the ending? Okay, I'll stop talking about it. But anyway, I'm looking forward to seeing this movie because I did so much. We went to this place called Lidice, and when Hitler heard about the attempted assassination of his best friend, he ordered Himmler to round up in Czechoslovakia immediately 10,000 Czechs to be executed in retaliation for Heydrich. That was the day after the attempted assassination. And they went into investigating who could have possibly pulled off this assassination attempt, because the Gestapo was everywhere. So they finally found a bicycle that one of the commandos had ridden in on, and they traced it back to a shop somewhere in Prague, and then back to a previous owner. Anyway, they went through this process of finding out, if they could, who the assassins were. And they found them, actually found the guys, in a church in that area. They had been buried, what do they call it, a crypt? They'd been buried in a crypt, which is like, I guess, a hollow space where they are going eventually to bury somebody. I'm not sure what a crypt is. Anyway, these guys were hiding out in a crypt in a church. And there were some people that, you know, wanted to get the reward, so they told on them. And so they were rounded up and executed. But it's kind of funny, they were actually made their way to a church. One of them was wounded, I think. And they got to this church, and they were discovered there. But anyway, the investigation that they turned up was that somehow or other, this little town of maybe 2,000 people were responsible for helping the assassins. This little town was called Lidice. Well, I mean, it was just a bunch of farmers, and none of them knew anything about the assassination, or they didn't help anybody. It was just an attempt by Hitler to get, you know, retaliation. So he gave orders to have all the men slaughtered in the village. All the women were to be raped and then sent to concentration camps to be gassed. All the children were to be, if they were under 6 years old, they were to be given to German families so they could be raised properly as Germans. It was a plan called Germanization. That happened all through Germany during this period of time. They still figured that they could take people that were white and convert them to good Nordic, German, Aryan people. So if they were under six, they could be Germanized. If they were between six and 14, they were sent to death camps also with the women. So that cleared out the village. And then Hitler ordered all the buildings burned. And they burned all the buildings. Yeah.
Oh, but just while I'm thinking about it. Okay, so if they took some kids, is that what happened to our Secretary of State, Madeleine Albright, when they found out she had Jewish roots?
No, she was taken, right. And she didn't even know she was Jewish. I mean, she didn't know until she was older.
So was she part of the ones taken or not?
No,
how did she probably get out of the way?
She probably had partisans in the family, and they brought them with non-Jewish families.
They went all over Europe. Of course, they conquered Europe. Yeah. So they went everywhere in Europe looking for enemy to kill. And in the process of doing that, they came across children. And some of these children, they said, you know what, we could probably rehabilitate these kids and make them good Germans. Because, of course, they were losing people, you know, through war and starvation and, you know, disease and so forth. So they were a little bit worried about their population. And so they, I forgot how many kids were rounded up and put into German homes, and I don't know anything about whether Albright was one of those or not. But I'm sure there have been some that have written about it. It is staggering when you go to start looking into writing about the Third Reich or the Nazis or Hitler. It's staggering how many books have been written. And see if I have any of them laid out here. This is one. This is the first volume of a two-volume set by Ian Kershaw on Hitler. And so this one is, you know, it's 800 pages, and then volume two, I think, is the same. And about 10 or 15 books that I've got are all that size. They're huge books. This is The Origins of Nazi Genocide. These are hard books to read because they're long and they're detailed and you don't want to read them. You know, it's just, when they opened up the concentration camps, the Russians came in 44 to Danzig and began to liberate concentration camps. The British and the Americans started opening up Bergen-Belsen, Dachau. They opened up a couple of them in 63. So a few weeks later, the Allied, American and British, they started opening up concentration camps. And I have one book that I've been reading. This one's called The Nazi State and German Society. And what it is a collection of episodes from sort of ordinary people. Well, you know, people that were picked up and put in camps and survived. And also excerpts from Hitler and Himmler and Heydrich and people like that. So 1, 2, 3 pages for each one of those. So it's amazing to read through some of these pieces because they're descriptions of what was going on. So they would go into these... A woman was saying that they would go into these camps and they would, the soldiers, Allied soldiers, would liberate the camps, open up the gates, go and get the German citizens who lived in those towns that surrounded the camps. Citizens who had smelled burning flesh for years and saw the trains come in loaded, the cattle cars come in loaded with victims. And all of them pretended they didn't know what was going on. I don't know if y'all saw the movie the other day on Turner Channel, Judgment at Nuremberg.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Eichmann. Is that the Eichmann trial?
No, Eichmann was in Jerusalem. They tried him in Jerusalem.
This is Nuremberg.
Yeah, this is the Nuremberg trial. The Nuremberg laws, Nuremberg was sort of a basic place for the Nazi rallies. And so the laws to eliminate all the bad people in the world, all the bad races, all the inferiors, all the degenerates, those laws were passed in 1935 in Nuremberg. So after the war was over, they thought it was, you know, poetic justice to go back to Nuremberg, which was pretty much destroyed by then. But they went back there to the Reichstag, and they held these trials in the same place with some of the same judges that had passed these laws 10 years earlier. I found that movie, I've seen it maybe three times in my life, but I just saw it, what, 2 days ago. And it reminded me of what I was talking about tonight, you know, about how do you make a better world. And it's a very interesting scene where Burt Lancaster finally stands up. He's tired of all the crap he's hearing from his buddies, that they didn't know what was going on, that they were innocent, that they were just doing their job. But he was a respected jurist and had written books and was sort of renowned worldwide as a kind of like Oliver Wendell Holmes in America. And he finally stood up and said, oh, this is crap, you know. We ought to take what's coming to us because we deserve it. And then the final scene, Spencer Tracy's leaving, going back to America, trial's over. And he's asked by the defense attorney, Maximilian Schell, to go by the prison and visit with Janitz, what was his name? Something Janitz, I think it was. Yeah, and visit with him because he had something he wanted to ask him or say to him. So he went to the cell, and the prisoner, Burt Lancaster, hands him some things he's written, memoirs and so forth. He wanted him to have them. And then they have this sort of brief discussion. And Spencer Tracy says to him, when you sentenced the first innocent man to punishment, knowing he was innocent, that was the end of the German Reich. That was the beginning of the end of the German Reich. And what's interesting about that is everything that we value in this country and everything that civilization has valued for thousands of years, going back to the Greeks, has been, what are our basic freedoms that we value? That are in our Declaration of Independence, Bill of Rights, Constitution. What are those basic freedoms? See, you don't know. And the pursuit of happiness. Well, it's not happiness, actually. They changed that later. Trump made them change that later. But originally, it was life, liberty, and the opportunity to succeed. Lincoln was not a happy person. In fact, he was a clinical depressed person. But he said that the one thing he thought we have to have in America was everybody should have the opportunity to rise to his own level of excellence, whether it's low or whether it's high. So the idea was life, liberty, and the opportunity for happiness. But we've sort of, you know, because of Vanna White, we've sort of dumbed down, you know, as a result of watching Wheel of Fortune for 2 decades. But the wording of Hitler's speeches, which he was famous for, they would last for hours, and they would mesmerize people. Women would swoon and faint. This little jerky little guy, you know, that couldn't get a date, and women were just falling all over him because his powerful oratory. It's the one skill he said that he was going to develop. He didn't have any ideas. He wasn't like an intellectual. I'm surprised he was able, most people are surprised that he wrote this book, and it doesn't make much sense anyway if you read it. It's kind of like reading the Quran. Has anybody read the Quran?
Yeah.
Man. Maybe it's better in Arabic, but in English it's like, damn.
Copy.
Huh?
Scattered random copy.
It doesn't follow what we typically call storytelling or books or essays or logic or something. It just skips around. But Hitler was on record as saying, we hate unions, we hate democracy, we hate the weakness of Jesus, because Jesus was strong when he threw the money changers out of the temple. That's the only time Jesus lived up to his reputation. All this stuff about forgiveness and tolerance and all this stuff. And I think he was influenced by Nietzsche and by Hegel and a few other German philosophers of the 1800s. Although he didn't say much about how much he read these guys, he must have been influenced by them, because many of the things he said, the Ubermensch, the Superman, was sort of taken from Nietzsche's writings. Nietzsche went insane at the end of his life in the 1890s, and they think it's because he had gonorrhea or syphilis. I think it was syphilis. And he was sort of, so his nervous system was kind of gone crazy, and he was beginning to become kind of crazy, you know, like Van Gogh, who I think also had syphilis, didn't he? How'd they cure syphilis back in those days? Was it mercury? Mercury poisoning. Yeah. Anyway, all these ideas of that we would consider to be valuable for a better society have to do with all these freedoms. Freedom of press, freedom of dissent, freedom to have any kind of opinion and to state that opinion, like we're famous for here, one fool at a time gets to, you know, make a fool of himself. And that's the, you know, that's the basis of democracy and governance by the people. Hitler hated that idea. He thought that the only successful society would be run by one powerful man. Him, yeah. But he got that from Bismarck. Bismarck had set up the institution of politics in Germany in 1871. And it was scary then, because Bismarck happened to be a fairly intelligent, decent human being, but he left this power vacuum, like whoever steps into this office, you know, could abuse it tremendously. And it was just a matter of time before Hitler did step in there and did abuse it. So you could look back at Bismarck, who was a powerful leader. You could look back at Martin Luther, who started the Reformation in 1517 and basically established the German language as a result of translating the Bible from the Vulgate and the Latin into German, and was a anti-Semite. I don't know if y'all knew that or not, but
yes. Big time. Yes.
What? Is this anthropoid? Huh?
Yeah.
Oh, good. Thanks. What was I saying?
Bismarck anti-Semite.
Huh?
You were talking about Martin Luther.
Oh, Martin Luther. Yeah. Actually, I knew what I was talking about. I just wanted to test to see if anybody was listening.
Yeah. Yeah.
And sure enough, nobody was. Yeah, Martin Luther was a avowed anti-Semite. And you think, well, now, he was a monk. Where did he get that from? He got it just like the guy that gave the idea of anti-Semitism directly to Hitler while they were in prison, or shortly after he was released, a Cistercian monk, of all people, a guy named Lanz, I think, had strange, bizarre ideas about the evil of the Jewish people because they killed Jesus. And God killers, Jesus killers. So I was, I read a book a couple of years ago about where anti-Semitism comes from in Christianity. It came from the architect of the Christian religion, founder of the Christian. I had a test in my class a couple of years ago, a class on world religion, and one of my questions was, so who was the founder of Christianity?
Apostle Paul.
And a very, very good-looking blonde said, I think his name was Ivan. Really? Seemed like a kind of a giveaway question, you know, like you could have just said Christ. But the guy that actually, because Christianity was disallowed by the Romans until 315.
St. Augustine.
He came a little bit later. Yeah, he came a few years later. Huh?
Councils of Nicaea.
Council of Nicaea, 325. Yeah, that was when they started putting together the books that we now call the New Testament. And originally there were 55 books in the New Testament. But they didn't agree with each other. Some of the books said Jesus had a girlfriend named Mary, and they had a child. Mary Magdalene actually wrote a gospel called the Gospel of Mary, and that was destroyed. So when Constantine called this, he made Christianity into the religion of Rome, he said, I'm not a philosopher. I believe in Apollo. I've never converted to Christianity, but I won the battle that made me the emperor because I followed my wife's attitude toward Christianity to put the symbol of the cross on the shields of my soldiers. And we won the battle against the former emperor of Rome, the Caesar, just because we were inspired by this sign that occurred in the sky. He went out to pray to Apollo the night before the battle. And Constantine had already fought two major battles from other powerful Caesars. I guess there were three sub-Caesars and one primary Caesar. And he was married to the daughter of the primary Caesar. But she had converted to Christianity. He fought two other battles on the way to Rome, and then he had to face up to the legion, the main legion in Rome, against his father-in-law. And they had never lost a battle. And he had, he was a teenager. He was like 19 or 21 years old, just a kid. But his dad had died, and he took over the area around Germany and England. And the Caesar, his father-in-law, said, well, you're too young to run, an area, that size. Now that your father's gone, we'll send somebody. And so they sent some people to run that area, and this Constantine attacked them and killed them and sent their remains back to Rome and said, don't send anybody else. And of course, that was a slap in the face of the Caesar. So he said, okay, well, now you've got to come face me. So he went down there and got to the bridge. What's the bridge called?
River Quay.
Tom. 313, the bridge was Miletus. Was it Miletus? Something like that. Anyway, they met at this bridge, and they were going to fight the next morning. So he told his wife, he said, well, we're going to all be killed tomorrow. Your father will save you and, your mother. But all of us soldiers are going to die tomorrow. We're weak. We've lost a lot of our men. We're exhausted from marching, down here, and we're going up against the most famous legion in the world. So we have no chance. It's Friday night, so I'm going to go out and pray to Apollo. And he goes out there and he looks up in the sky. The sun, Apollo, and he sees this sign appear in the sky, in Latin. In victorious ignorance, whatever it's called. In this sign you will be victorious. And it was the sign of the cross. He didn't know what it was. So he goes back home and he talks to his wife and he says, a strange thing happened. I get out there and this thing appears in the sky that if I use this sign, I'll be victorious. What is this sign? And she said, oh, that's the sign of the cross. That was Jesus. That was the power of Jesus communicating to you. So he had all of his men put the sign of the cross on their shields. And they went out the next day and won. So there's a wonderful book called Constantine's Sword by a former priest, James Carroll, who uncovered a lot of material about anti-Semitism in the Catholic Church. And in this book, Constantine's Sword, he talks about this battle. And how after the battle, and he's now the Caesar over all of Rome, the Roman Empire, he decides that as a tribute to Jesus, although he's not converted, he's not going to worship Jesus, he is going to recognize his power by making the Christian religion the religion of the Roman Empire. So he opens up all the jails, lets all the Christians that have been persecuted out, and forms into a bishop, a group of bishops, and he says, I want you all to get together. First they went to Nicaea, and then I think later it was Chalcedon, and they had to put together something for this emperor, this Caesar, that he could understand about this new religion that he had made the religion of the Roman Empire. And he said to him, now look, I'm not a philosopher, I'm not a literary man, I'm a soldier. Give me a little pamphlet kind of a thing that'll be easy to read and that's kind of consistent all the way through. My understanding that a lot of different opinions about who Jesus was and what he said and all this stuff, said, I don't want to be confused because I'm a military man. Just give me a little military manual. So they took these 55 books and they went through them and they had to eliminate some of them because they painted a picture of Jesus that differed from other people's picture. You know, like he was not just a god, he was a real man. I mean, he had, you know, he was angry sometimes, he was horny sometimes. It was like he was just another, you know, human being. And the bishops decided that they would not let all those books appear in the New Testament. So of the 55, they wound up with 27, which is now the current number in the New Testament. And we had no idea what these books were because they were all destroyed by order of the Caesar. Strange thing happened after World War II in a little town in Egypt, a town called Nag Hammadi. Two boys were playing in the caves close by the Nile, and they uncovered an urn, and they didn't know what it was, but it was a big pot, you know. And they uncovered it, and then they thought, the way people in the desert think, that it might hold a genie. Genie, J-I-N-I-I, or something like that, whatever that original spelling is. Genies were like these little elves or powers or something that... Leprechaun, whatever, they were little powers that existed in nature. And they could do harm and they could do good things, you know. So they were nervous, because they were like 10 years old, and they were nervous that if they broke into this urn that they were fascinated by, it might release a genie and they could be, you know, harmed. But you know how kids are. Curiosity killed the cat. So they broke this this big urn, which apparently was like 5 or 6 feet tall and big around, and it had all the original books of the Bible in it. So the priests, when they realized that they're all being destroyed, they took it upon themselves. These were probably pre-Benedictine monks or something out there. They call the desert monks. And they probably stacked all these scriptures into this urn and buried it. Just like the Dead Sea Scrolls were found in a similar way, in a similar place, at a similar time, 1947. And it's fascinating what these the story behind this discovery of the Nag Hammadi. Because these boys found this scroll, what they call codexes, they found them rolled up inside this urn. They weren't readers, they didn't know what the writing was on there. Okay, thank y'all. So they took these scrolls. They were like skins that had been written on in an ancient language, Demotic Greek or something. And they took them back to their mother in the afternoon, 5, 6 in the afternoon, and she was about to make dinner. So they brought these scrolls in, these 2,000-year-old skins, kind of dry, and put them in the kitchen because they didn't know what to do with them. And the mother said, well, I'm going to cook dinner anyway. I'll just use them to start the fire. So she took these priceless manuscripts and she was sticking them in the oven to make bread. But the boys were outside playing and they had a neighbor who was a professor at the University of Cairo. And they were talking about what they had discovered, and he heard them. And he was like, you know, my God, you found scrolls in a cave, and he ran over there and he starts pulling them out of the fire. And for about 20 or 25 years, these scrolls were on the black market, kind of priceless on the black market. They were taken to Berlin, they were taken to New York and put in a safety deposit box. They were, two people were killed on a train somewhere in Romania. I mean, it's like they had a real strange history. And of course, all the time they're being moved around, they're being affected, you know, damaged. Finally, they showed up and were confiscated and put in the University of Cairo in the basement where the temperature and humidity was good. And they invited four or five experts, a woman from Princeton named Pagels, who was a student of the Coptic language. They invited these people from the world who knew this language to come in and translate. And of course, when you translate now, you take pictures first because the deterioration is set in place, so you want to capture as much of the manuscript as you can. So she spent years with this group translating these scriptures, and they're available now in a book called The Other Christian Bible. It includes all the books that, when I went through seminary, we knew who these books were because we knew all the things wrong with them. These were all the heretical writings, you know, Arianism and Pelagianism and all these things that were hateful. But we didn't know what the original documents were. We just knew what the people that hated them said about them, you know. So now we actually have these, and they're amazing. If you ever come across any of these books, one's called the Gnostic Gospels. Yeah, that's one of the books. And yeah, there's a couple of books out there by these people that are, and what Elaine Pagels did when she did these translations was she realized that Christianity, which had always been a male-dominated religion, in fact, had a lot of female authority to it in the early Christian community. I mean, if you read the New Testament, you see how Jesus was always interacting with females and elevating them, you know, forgiving them for adultery and talking about how good they were and so forth. So it wasn't like it originally was a male-dominated religion, as it became later, because it was adopted by a Roman Caesar, you know, who was a military guy. So anyway, Elaine Pagels has had a tremendous influence on the church in the last 20 years because she had begun to see how Christianity had developed into a kind of a misogynistic religion, putting down, suppressing women and so forth. I went to church, it was probably 10, 15 years ago, I went to a church, a Methodist church over by where I live. A friend of mine was a minister there. And when it came time to do the Lord's Prayer, this is the result, this is the influence of Elaine Pagels. She said, okay, let's bow our head and say the Lord's Prayer. But let me start it off. And then she said, our Father, Mother, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. And we're all going, that doesn't sound right, you know. Our Father, Mother, who art in heaven. As if God didn't have a gender, you know. Who knows? Okay. All right. Can I read something?
Sure.
Bad lighting. Isn't there a little light up here somewhere?
Oh, yeah, there is.
Switch it on.
Well, I was just going to read this. This letter from Hitler. No light? Oh, there we go. Anyway, he's just going on this last, it's a two-page thing called My Political Testament. This is called Mein Kampf, which is my struggle. And it sounds like he was sort of a halfway, you know, decent human being in some of these words. I also made it quite plain that if the nations of Europe are again to be regarded as mere shares to be bought and sold by these international conspirators in money and finance, then that race that does that, the Jews, are the real criminals in this murderous struggle. And they will be saddled with the responsibility forever. St. Augustine, to go back to St. Augustine, said, when he was the architect of Christianity, you should never kill a Jew. We should not kill Jews. They killed Jesus, but we're not going to kill them. We want to keep them alive so we can torment them forever. So murder would be too nice for them.
Who said that?
St. Augustine. And this is in the book Constantine's Sword by the former priest named James Carroll, who was alarmed a couple of years ago at a concentration camp when the local priest came in and started planting crosses in this cemetery where the Jews were buried after the death camps. And it was Christianity that had had such a strong influence on Hitler. Hitler was raised Catholic. He doesn't talk about his beliefs that much or the Catholic doctrine that much. But there's some evidence that he picked up a lot of his biases as a result of being raised by priests. He said, I have decided, therefore, to remain in Berlin and there of my own free will to choose death at the moment when I believe the position of the Führer and Chancellor itself can no longer be held. But I die with a happy heart, aware of the immeasurable deeds and achievements of our soldiers at the front, our women at home, the achievements of our farmers and workers, and the work, unique in history, of our youth who bear my name. From the bottom of my heart, I express my thanks to all of you. It's self-evident, as my wish should be, that you and no one else, on account of our struggle, but continue forever against the enemies of the fatherland, no matter where, true to the creed of the great Clausewitz. The rules of war? From the sacrifice of our soldiers and from my own unity with them unto death, in any case will spring up in the history of Germany the seed of a radiant renaissance of the National Socialist movement, and thus of the realization of a true community of societies. Sounds kind of hopeful. Above all, I charge the leaders of the nation and those under them to scrupulously observe all the laws of race and to mercilessly oppose to the universal prisoners of all people, international jury. Goodbye. So the last word he wanted to say was, you know, against the Jews. One of many groups that he hated. Yeah, this is Anthropoid, Angelica film. And when's it gonna be out? Friday the 12th. Last night. Yeah, my sister and I are going to go see that. Okay, we're going to do something else now. Oh, okay.
First of all, thank you. Thank you so much for coming, and best of wishes on your doctorate. You deserve it. I mean, you seem like
I'm going to put you on my committee. You can be on my committee.
I would love it. I have a long history with SMU too, and you're in a wonderful place.
Do you know the word eugenics?
Yes.
Yeah.
Y'all know that word?
Exactly. Yes.
That was the other part of my speech that I didn't get around to. Maybe I'll do it sometime. I'll do it again sometime. But eugenics is how do you select the kind of people that we need and get rid of the kind of people we don't need.
Right.
That was what Hitler. And guess where he got eugenics from?
America. It was here.
The Southerners in America were sterilizing prisoners and blacks and the feeble-minded. Our greatest jurist, perhaps in history, was Oliver Wendell Holmes. And he said that it's good to sterilize people that are feeble-minded and that don't contribute to society. And he's famous for saying, three generations of imbeciles, that's enough. So one of the famous cases, the Buck case, which lasted for years, traced the family of a woman of an ancestry that had a huge number of criminals, feeble-minded, alcoholics, prostitution. And so the judge finally, when that person came to trial, they said, well, she definitely needs to be sterilized and everybody like her. Because three generations of imbeciles, kind of a famous quote from Holmes. And there's the book, a guy named Lombardo wrote this book. I'm sorry, go ahead.
Oh, no problem. Is it true, and if so, could you speak to the practice? I've heard that rather than Christianity, which you, like you pointed out, that Hitler wasn't particularly fond of Christ's softer aspects, but the appeal to the old gods, the Nordic, the Odin and Woden, and the
Old Testament god.
Early,
eye for an eye, tooth for tooth, retaliation.
It,
yeah.
Well, is it correct that the Reich used those early, not so much the Old Testament, the Bible, but I mean the ancient Scandinavian gods, Odin and Woden, and the Nordic myths, and used that to kind of appeal to the collective consciousness and unconsciousness to pull people together.
There were, that's an interesting question.
Carl Jung wrote a lot about myth in our kind of collective unconscious, and there was a chapter in a book.
Yeah, one of the books that I haven't read yet is on the occult influences.
That's it. Occult influence, exactly.
Yeah,
and
it's amazing. I mean, the whole idea of the swastika.
Yes.
You know, was borrowed from the Hindus, and it was a giant wheel that was gonna crush all the bad things in life. I mean, there's the symbols of violence and power and murder were all woven into the fabric, you know, of the Nazi regime. And that book talks about all the different symbols. There was one group of the SS, the stormtroopers, and the SAs and the SS, they had a special unit called the Death's Head, and it was a skull that they wore on their lapel or ring or something. And they were dedicated to violence and power, and, you know, this is a good day to die, that kind of thing, you know. The ideology of the Nazi regime was filled with a lot of pseudo-religious, occult, mythic kinds of things. Because Hitler was going anywhere he could to arouse people to be irrational. Because he didn't know how to appeal to their reason, but he could appeal to their other side, the demon side.
And it did so with those symbols that evoked some kind of this kind of brutal.
They're deeper. Yeah, they're in our
ancient, DNA, and Carl Jung had explored that, and I always thought that was really interesting.
Yeah, the question that comes up a lot with Hitler and the Third Reich was he a human being or was he a reptile? Because so many of the people that ran the machinery called the Third Reich, the SS, the guards at the concentration camp, they were chosen because they had no feeling. They weren't chosen because they were rabid haters of Jews or Poles or communists. They were chosen because they were bureaucrats. They could work without remorse. They could, like a doctor does when he's doing surgery, he can't.
Those are called sociopaths and psychopaths.
That's they're psychopaths and sociopaths.
Yeah. But a doctor, when he goes to do surgery, he's got to put aside his emotions.
That's different. Because when they're not doing it, they're still, they're more out.
Yeah.
This is not normal. Do you think an Adolf Hitler would have been evolved in any other country than Germany?
You mean like Donald Trump has in our country?
Something like that.
I was amazed at how many statements I've heard Trump make in the last few weeks with the books I'm reading on Hitler. almost word for word. I mean, you could. So I read something recently that said that one of the books or one of the people that's been most influential in Trump's education was Adolf Hitler. But that's true of Henry Ford and Nelson Rockefeller and H.G. Wells and
Bush.
And I mean, a whole bunch of people that are famous and who were proponents of eugenics initially when it was, you know, in America back in the 20s. It's a list of powerful, oftentimes, you know, good people, you know, that we think are good people.
Okay. Did you see Trump's speech at the Republican convention? I'm asking you the question because I wanted to make a comment about that for you to comment on.
I can't remember if I saw
how much. 20 minutes.
Yeah, I don't think I saw that whole thing. I might have seen a piece of it, but.
Well, because I watched it, and he had this black podium, and he had these multi-story golden columns on each side of him.
What does that remind you of?
Albert Speer.
Yeah.
And that's what I was going to ask you, if you noticed that or not.
No, I don't think I did, but it makes sense.
Didn't see it,
yeah, I didn't see him.
Hello, Dex.
What's up?
Are you familiar with the term pseudepigraphica?
Yeah.
Are you familiar with the fact that many historians recognize that the Gnostic Gospels, were actually written after Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, and that many of them partake, especially the Gospel of Mary Magdalene, is not suspected of being written by Mary Magdalene herself.
Oh.
Were you aware of that?
Well, I was aware that none of the scriptures are written by the peoples whose name is on them. So Mark didn't write the Gospel of Mark. Matthew didn't write the Gospel of Matthew. Solomon didn't write the Wisdom of Solomon. All those names were added to those written documents because the writers, the original writers, were sort of anonymous. And then you wanted to use certain names that were powerful.
And the Gospel of John?
I don't know if John...
That's highly likely, but he lived to be 90 years old.
He was a outcast among the gospel writers because he was in conflict with Matthew, Mark, and Luke. He was in conflict with their attitude toward those three original, what they call the synoptic gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. They're all promote a Jesus who is as much a man as he is a God or a Christ figure. John, not so much. John was, he wanted to elevate Jesus to the Christ of the universe. So there was a debate within Christianity when this was going on, when they were trying to decide which gospels were first, which ones were more authentic, because none of them agree with anybody else. I mean, they all disagree on certain aspects. So I was aware that the actual name of the people that penned these things is probably not be known and could probably never be known.
Were you aware that by 1926, Rockefeller had donated $410,000 to German eugenics?
Yeah. And Henry Ford...
That doesn't make it a Southern... that's a Northern...
No, he went to Mississippi University. That's where he was trained.
I see. Were you aware of the stories that have emerged that in fact Adolf Hitler was interviewed by Standard Oil before he became prominent?
No, he was in contact with the Carnegie Institute, with Rockefeller, with
don't forget the city of London.
There were several powerful people. Harvard, I think, was involved. They were all promoting eugenics to make a better society, and Hitler heard about it and contacted both people in Britain and people in America to see if they could help him with his program. And there was a sheriff in Virginia. They were rounding up.
Well, unfortunately, Jan left, but what I was trying to ask you was whether you were aware that Adolf Hitler was the actor chosen to promote the agenda of Standard Oil.
No, I don't think I ever heard that before.
Okay. Are you aware of the interrogation of Christian Rakowski?
Of who?
Christian Rakowski. He was interrogated and murdered under Stalin.
I don't think I know that name.
He gives a very credible account of the Rothschilds raising up of Adolf Hitler to take out Stalin because they had lost control of Stalin. He had gone Bonapartist.
Yeah, Rothschild was Jewish, right? That was like the wealthiest Jewish family?
Really doesn't matter. They were the wealthiest family.
Yeah. Yeah, I think the Rothschilds were. And I think they were in France, weren't they? Does that sound right?
They were all over. They were in London, France.
Yeah.
New York.
Yeah, back in the 60s, the late 60s, when they taught Civil War in the colleges, usually the names that came up were Robert Rep, Hinton Rowan Helper, and a book called Slavery, the Peculiar Institution.
Stamp's book, yeah.
Yeah, are those three still the core? When you went through there, was Robert Rep still one of the key educational components along with Hinton Rowan Helper's works, or have they expanded somewhat?
Stamp was the one that really rings a bell. And that phrase that he coined, the peculiar institution, always sounded odd to me. I mean, slavery of 11 million people, you know, elimination of millions in those middle passage across there, and they call it peculiar? It just sounded like it was a sanitization, you know, of...
Something else you said, which kind of stuck with me. I got
into the mic.
Yeah, I received a few emails during the election campaign about Donald Trump, and I thought, well, I'll go to my bookshelf. I have the Koran there. I have the Mormon Bible in the back seat of my car, which has been there for 20 years. Hmm. I have Torahs. I've got all kinds of books, and I have a copy or two of Chairman Mao's works in the original red books.
You have English
and Chinese.
You got the Mein Kampf?
No, I don't know that I have it. I'm sure that I can pull it down somewhere if I want to. But I have books of equal, I guess, chilling value, yet to me, those who say that rubs off. I mean, that's kind of like the Fahrenheit 451 gang. You know, let's just burn the books. You have to know what people are saying. You have to know the difference between didactical Marxism and capitalism. You have to know Chairman Mao's theory of protected warfare. That doesn't mean you're going to be a military general and take over China, but there's certain basic readings, and just to have the book on your shelf, even if it's by your bedside, I don't think connotates anything more than somebody reads and they're intelligent enough to read something and bounce it off. I mean, Warren Buffett said something years ago, a man with a plan or a fool with a plan is worth more than a man with no plan at all. And I'm not agreeing with the Hitlerian concepts, but I'm saying people shouldn't criticize those who read books, because that was the whole premises of, was it Truffaut and Fahrenheit 451? Let's not think, let's not remember, let's not read the books. And I get very irritating when I hear people say, well, Donald Trump has this and so-and-so has that by their bedside. Don't mean a thing unless they're following some sort of horrendous plan. And last I know, Donald Trump didn't set up any concentration camps. Maybe the U.S. government did during World War II. The Japanese were interned. We know about that.
Yeah.
But I don't think just to have knowledge of books imputes that the person is super gifted.
No, but
or
when
super
a man
evil.
When a man runs for president and he speaks to the country and he can't remember anything, he can't make, you know, sensible paragraphs, he can't run through an entire thought without demeaning some minority or gender, or I mean, it's like, how's that gonna represent, you know, America to the rest of the world?
Well, the same way as somebody who doesn't have a clue over security, and we'll leave it at that.
You're back.
Yes, I never left. Is it true that Mark Alfred Sanger, the founder of Planned Parenthood, was also one of the founders of the American eugenics movement.
Yes.
The eugenics movement has two interesting aspects to it. It's got the positive aspect and the negative aspect. And it's not scary until recently with the Genome Project, because earlier we didn't really know a lot about heredity or what could be done to tamper with the DNA code of life. But now that we know how that operates, it's scarier because we could actually prevent future generations from having a certain genetic diversity.
That's a nice thought. That's not the question. The question is it true that Margaret Sanger, the founder of the Planned Parenthood, was one of the founders, and if not one of the founders, certainly one of the chief promulgators of the eugenics movement back in the world of the teens and the 20s?
It started back in 1915, 1920, 1910. That's when the eugenics movement started. And then because it was associated with Hitler in the 30s.
Hitler wasn't around in the teens and the 20s.
Well, oh, yeah,
he was. Around, but he was nothing then. But the question was, is it true? I think it is true. Margaret Sanger was one of the leading proponents of eugenics movement. And she wasn't talking about helping people. She was talking about murder and putting them to death, having them sterilized.
Yeah, I have never.
All such a. You weren't aware of it.
Never heard that before.
You ought to read her.
I know her name because I've been reading some of the books that mention her.
It's a good one. There. Well, I got to know.
Might have been a reason, but I don't think
it's. They would explain Planned Parenthood in a different way.
That's just too weird. I mean, that's not what it is today. That's not what it became.
Yeah. Right.
When you opened your talk most appropriately with the discussion of utopia and the origins of utopia, you mentioned Plato. Can you say what book or what work that his reference to utopia was?
Republic.
Oh, it was in the Republic. Okay.
Yeah.
I missed that. Okay, thank you very much.
And one of my favorite parts of the Republic is the thing called the allegory of the cave.
Yes.
So we use that in our classes because it's kind of short and, to the point. And it's all about the importance of enlightenment and how dangerous it is to be enlightened, because then your friends will kill you because they don't want to be enlightened. They prefer the dark and the shadows and the illusions and so forth. It's pretty.
I loved that in the discussions we had of the allegory of the cave.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. I enjoyed your remarks. I guess I was somewhat confused by the subject of how to make a more perfect world.
Talk to the mic, please, so we can hear you.
Can I hear you? Eat the mic.
Is that better?
Yeah, that's good.
Okay. I looked at the subject of how to make the world a better world, and a more perfect world. And you talked about the Jacobin movement, Hitler, and Bismarck, constantly. But we never, and then you talked about one of the points where education was the solution, and you seemed to question that. How can we make a more perfect world? That's my question.
What was the question?
How can we make a more perfect world?
By having perfect people.
I've given up on the idea of perfect. I think that's wrong, because it always means that whoever gets in power will be the one to determine what's perfection,
yes,
and what's right and what's the standard. And so you can never depend on it being equally distributed in a just way through all the people. And there's always been a condemnation of the feeble-minded, the village idiot, the imbeciles, the morons. When I spent the summers with my grandparents, there was always people that were slow around that little town. And they fit in fine. I mean, people, you didn't have to be bright because nobody went to college. I think I was the first in my family that's ever gone to college. You didn't have to have high intelligence. The world was not complex back then. to make a better world now, we're all planning on how we're going to turn to the computer and the smartphone and the smart car, and, you know, the world will be run by computers someday. Well, how are the village idiots going to survive when everybody else is so highly educated? I mean, it'll take an entire 10% of the population or more and shovel them off to the ditches somewhere. I think that's the problem with thinking in terms of you could actually pull off a perfect world, because there's always an agenda that goes along with it.
In the first paragraph, you are stating that have laws, juries, police, etc. proved effective? Question mark. Dexter will argue, quote, only partially, unquote. Laws don't change the human heart. Are you alluding to something as in, I thought they taught over at the Perkins School of Theology, may not anymore, that an encounter with the Son of the Living God, Jesus Christ, changes men's and women's hearts? Were you alluding to that?
I'm sorry, I didn't get that last part.
Were you alluding, okay, you're saying your laws don't change the human heart. Then what does? Are you alluding to a religious experience between Jesus Christ and the unregenerate heart changing someone's heart?
I don't know if that happens or not. I know
that's
it's
what
had
Constantine said.
It's had an effect on me, but I think that can be done if you confess that, like Abraham Lincoln did in the cabinet. That's one thing, but then to say, like the church says, that you're supposed to have that happen to you or you're not a true Christian or a true believer, I have problems with that. And that's the big difference between a liberal seminary like Perkins and Dallas Theological Seminary. It's a difference between a Methodist or an evangelical. There's an absolute nature to it that I find to be suspicious, because it elevates the person that's saying it to the stature of all-knowing. And I think that's blasphemous, so.
I think the FBI came out with the information that Hitler really didn't die, that he went to.
Yeah,
you didn't mention that, because you're aware.
No, I'm convinced he died.
I'm sorry?
I'm convinced he died. Yeah. Did you see the movie Boys from Brazil?
Oh my God, I read
that. Wasn't
the book.
That amazing?
Oh my God, I read the book.
Yeah, it's a that's a famous.
Wow.
Yeah, how did Hitler, with this ideal Aryan race, square it with this horrible looking wizened entourage he had?
Yeah, he never did explain that, did he? Yeah. He doesn't look at all Nordic. I mean, he has these posters all over Germany, you know, with people with, you know, blue eyes and white hair like I have, you know. And here he is, you know, short, stumpy, you know, dark hair.
But his whole entourage, I mean, you know, Goebbels, wasn't
Heydrich. Heydrich did look like the poster child for the Aryan supremacy, yeah.
Maybe that's why Hitler was so upset when he...
Yeah, when he lost his poster boy, yeah.
But the rest of them look weird.
Well, Ernst Rehm, was his best friend growing up. Through the early stages of National Socialism, he and Rehm were like buddies. And when he found out a few years later, when he became chancellor, that his buddy was a homosexual, he had him executed. Yeah. And it really hurt him that he had to do that. But he was on record, you know, was against all sorts of degeneracy. And Rehm was famous, flagrantly homosexual in the bars around, you know, Berlin.
He didn't consider himself degenerate then.
No. But you ran a risk with Hitler to be anything, you know, promiscuous or, you know, odd in any way.
Oh, to get out.
He had all the artists, you know, modern artists, come to open up an exhibit. And he himself led the tour through there and talked about how this is an indication that we're all going into, you know, in the toilet. Because look how stupid these paintings are, you know.
The
Clay and Picasso, and who are these guys? They don't know what they're doing, you know, it's degeneracy.
And the Bauhaus architect.
Yeah, yeah, he, and you know, was it Marlene Dietrich that was singing in those cabarets, I think back in 28, 29, 30?
Yeah.
Apparently Berlin was like the seedbed of sexual corruption and stuff. I mean, it was like wide open, apparently. Hamburg and
the Weimar Republic, it certainly was, the cabaret scene there.
Yeah. Isn't that, that's the movie Cabaret, isn't it? The music, yeah.
But those were the good times, right? The Weimar,
I think it's time for somebody else to take over.
Sit down now.
Yeah.
Now we get to you.
Don't clap. Vote. Somebody said that the other day.
Comments.
Yeah, now it's time for, it's your turn to talk, so.
You can leave that stuff here if you want. You may need it. You can use stainless. I just say you get around and you get to the.
Are you going to go?
Yes, electric air material. Yeah, here we go, thanks.
Well, I think it is never more true that history is written by the victors. And the problem with a long talk like Dex's talk here is I get confused over the dozens of things I disagree with him about, and it's hard to put them all
together. Okay, that's it. You've had enough time. Go, you can quit now.
I rest my case. What was the Civil War begun over? The Civil War was begun over the moral tariff of 1861. That plundered the South, the agricultural South. And one Southern writer was asked, well, what were the causes of the Civil War? And he said, New England greed, New England fanatics, New England zealots, New England hypocrites. They were claiming, the South was claiming that the Northern industrialists were plundering the economies of the South through the tariffs to build up Northern industry. So they wouldn't have to pay a cent. There were four Southern states that bore most of the burden of that. When Abraham Lincoln was elected, they were already at the point of secession. This had been going on for decades. In the 1830s, they had a 50% tax. And then in 1857, they overturned it. And they had the 1857 tax, which was more, I think, along the lines of a 20% tax. Abraham Lincoln was coming in on a platform that he was going to raise the tax, the tariff. And they were ready to go. And who started the Civil War? The South claims the Civil War started when the North attacked them. Is secession an act of war? Secession is honored in our Constitution. If you read the wording of the Declaration of Independence, it says that you know, hey, if we're not happy with how government's going, we're out. So that's all a matter of perception. Lincoln attacked, he said, to preserve the Union. Well, the Union had already shattered. The reason they were able to pass the 1861 tariff was because Southern senators and congressmen had already left because their states were going into secession at that point, and they passed the tariff over them. So if you look at the American Revolution, that was started over taxation. Civil War started over taxation. Later on, Lincoln was losing the war, and he had to come up with a cause celeb to draw everybody together, and that cause celeb was slavery. And he was right. It's evil. Thomas Jefferson agreed with him. Many of the founders agreed with him. In their time, they were not able to get rid of slavery. It was so entrenched. But 500,000 deaths during the Civil War, I think it was actually more than that. I think it's near to 600,000. 800,000. Yeah, massive amount of deaths. If you go to the Civil War Memorial in Austin, Texas. It memorializes those who died for states' rights. Doesn't say anything about slavery there. Slavery is evil, folks. Today, I don't think there's anyone who won't admit that. But then the history books get rewritten. When I was Googling a while back, you could find that information. Do you know that the internet's being cleansed? I went to 20 sites before I even found the moral terror of 1861. Everything else said slavery. You, by the way, the way the meetings work is you have a chance to come up here and do your own rebuttal. So, as far as I wasn't expecting Dex to get into the Gospels and so forth. This is a very, very complex issue here because mostly what we attack in Christianity is in the nature of a straw man. Because Christianity itself is not what it was in the original church. I have rabbis from Jerusalem that I've heard talk, that I've met, shaken hands with, who talk to me about the synagogue of the apostles in Jerusalem. Of course, everything got ruined, but they're aware it was there. They know where it was. And that's because initially they didn't know that the Messiah hadn't come. There was great controversy there in Jerusalem. There were over 40 prophecies. There are over 40 prophecies that Jesus fulfilled. But what he didn't fulfill is the desires of the people, the desires of the Sanhedrin. They wanted an earthly Messiah who would come and kick butt and basically defeat the nations of the world. And that's not what happened. And that has never been resolved. There were several things that we take to be Judaism now that actually some of the positions of Judaism happened in those years after Jesus came, and they were attempting to distance themselves from the Christians whom the Romans were persecuting greatly. They were trying to say, we're not them. And so they took several different positions now, and I can't recall them at the moment, wasn't prepared for this. One good friend of mine from years back was Stefan Heller. Stefan Heller has wrote extensively on the Nag Hammadi and on the Gnostic Gospels. And I applaud Dr. Heller. I applaud his Gnostic Orthodox Church and everything he's involved in. I don't agree with him on a lot. It's a much different philosophy than what we take to be Christianity today. A lot of what we take to be Christianity is actually from Apostle Paul. And you can say Apostle Paul, he of course wasn't even with the disciples. So, you know, there's a lot of controversy there that I don't feel that Dex treated well. I don't believe the Gospel of Mary Magdalene was written by Mary Magdalene. There are many other people who concur that they really don't believe that many of the Gnostic Gospels were written by those they claim. And they were written according to some of the Gnostic beliefs to accentuate different points, to use the narrative of Jesus' life to make points on different things. Adolf Hitler and Standard Oil. I mean, no one seems to be aware of this, but I read articles years ago that, in fact, Adolf Hitler was interviewed and then backed, and that he had backing out of the city of London. Why did Rudolf Hess fly in a small plane and then was captured and held in isolation for the rest of his life? Because Hess held the key. Hess was coming over to check with the wealthy Rothschild bankers there in the city. Why did you pull our funding? We thought we were your golden boys. Well, in the interrogation of Christian Rakowski, that was explained to Stalin's people. Stalin had basically gone off of the plan that the Rothschilds laid out for Lenin, and they intended to have Trotsky in there.
Move on.
I don't know where we're getting the music from. Anyway, the whole thing about the interrogation of Christian Rakowski is the fact, if you look at it, that Hitler was raised up by the moneyed powers to take out Stalin because Stalin had not followed their wishes. Once Stalin agreed to go along with their program, they're like, oh, okay, we don't need Adolf, we'll cut him. And everything else is history. Was Adolf Hitler bitter about the whole thing? Sure he was. One of the big challenges with the Second World War and with Adolf Hitler was the phrase never again. I honestly really tried to figure that out. Never again. Why would we ever want another Adolf Hitler? Would we ever want another brutal dictator like that? And of course we wouldn't, but what made the man? What caused that to happen? I think we have all the wrong answers on that. I don't think Trump would ever be a Hitler, but we're not banned from having someone like that rise up because we've got the wrong causes. We don't understand what happened there. Thank you.
I guess Dexter gets to respond. There's no one else.
I'll make it.
Oh, he's going to make a comment. Can he make a comment and then you respond, be all right?
Yeah, give him 1 minute.
1 minute?
Yeah, he just gets 1 minute.
1 minute. With long seconds. 1 minute with long seconds. One thing that John said right in the beginning that I totally agree with, and that is, and I think it should be said over and over, and people should think about this. History is written by the winners. Therefore, it's got their perspective completely in the books that we have today. There are a lot of things about the whole events of World Wars I and II that we kind of just see in one categorical viewpoint because that's what we're taught. And it's not all that true, I think. Going back to 1914 when Prince Ferdinand of the Austro-Hungarian Empire was assassinated by some Serbians. That caused the Austro-Hungarian Empire to launch a military action against Serbia. Well, everybody thought that'll last a week or two and it'll be done with. Except that Serbia had a mutual defense treaty with Russia. So Russia came in and attacked Austria-Hungary. Well, Germany had a mutual defense treaty with the Austro-Hungarian Empire, so they were obliged to go in and attack Russia. Russia had a mutual defense treaty with France, and they attacked Germany, and then because Germany was in war with France, in comes England, they had a mutual defense treaty too. And then pretty soon the Japanese, who had a treaty with England, came in, and it just boiled down to, instead of something that was going to last a few weeks and be over with, it took 4 years, and I think it was 19 million people. A whole generation of young men from France were virtually wiped out. And so at the end of that war, tremendous hatred. And so when the Allies, if you'll call them that, won, and they forced the Treaty of Versailles on Germany. They took portions of Germany with German people and cut it out of Germany and attached them to Czechoslovakia and Poland. And Hitler said when he came to power, those people are coming back to Germany because those two countries didn't treat those people very well. And it was wrong to do that. It was done out of hatred. And that part of what he intended to do, I completely sympathize with. They should have been aggregated back into Germany. Hitler went nuts and became one of the most brutal human beings on earth. I'll never, think that he was a great man. But there are a lot of differences in history. Now, we look back on Germany back in the World War I era, and we have an ugly viewpoint of it. Otto Bismarck was one of the most brilliant diplomats that this world has ever had. Germany was a whole bunch of walled city-states because for centuries tribes had come through there and migrated, and they were constantly fighting with this people and that people, and these walled city-states were just still fighting. Germany was not a country in the 1800s. And he took and allied A with B, his friend, on mutual defense, and B with C, and they signed a treaty knowing that A and C were deadly enemies. Well, now they can't go to war with each other because their friend would come and defend the other. And he did this spider web of these kinds of treaties all over Germany and stopped all the warfare and made it cohesive into one country. And then he hired scholars to go around and find out all the best parts of all the different dialects and create what is called Hochdeutsch, or High German, the language that they speak today. Otto Bismarck made a comment that he thought the experiment being carried on in the United States of America may hold the hope of freedom for all mankind in the future. And we look at the Tsar of Russia back then. During our Civil War, he put his navy in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean and told France and England, if you try to get your colonies back, you will be at war with Russia. So there are a lot of things about history that are just different from what we've been taught. There were other things. I didn't take notes. I wish I had. Am I close? I passed my 1 minute, but to hell with that. I think we all need to, another thing I wanted, I've mentioned this before, I think everybody should read Jim Marr's book, The Rise of the Fourth Reich, because he is a hell of a researcher, and he has a lot of documentation that supports the idea that Germany got some 100,000 top Nazi officials out of Germany before the end of the war. The Roman Catholic Church issued documentation to a lot of people indicating that they were priests, and that got them out. And Martin Bormann, who was number two under Hitler, forms, I think it was over 750 international corporations and put billions of dollars, Deutsche Mark, into those companies, and that's the international corporate scene of today. I don't think we're through with Nazism at all. It's just evolved into another movement. And I used to have documentation before everything that I had was stolen that the Germans had developed MHD submarines, the Hunt for Red October. They didn't have propellers. They used electromagnetism to propel the water, and they were totally silent, and we couldn't find them with sonar and so forth. And they had developed the ability to launch a V-2 missile from a submerged submarine. The Polaris was not the first of those. And you can go on the internet now and look up German U-boats of World War II, and you can see a picture of a V-2 coming out of the ocean. And a friend of mine had a book that had a picture like that in it, taken from aboard a United States naval vessel in 1945. And if this is true, and if, according to the information I used to have, and I can't document it now, they had developed neutron bombs. They had placed 28 submarines off both coasts of the United States, and Admiral Dönitz contacted Allied headquarters and said, look, we need to make a deal. We want to save all these people. Of course, Allied headquarters would say, we've got the war won. And Dönitz essentially said, well, no, you haven't, because here are these submarines, and they had to give a test of it to prove it to them, right? So interestingly, late in the war, I think 1945, a regiment of Italian soldiers went into North Africa and disappeared. Nobody's ever heard from them again. And there is a city there where, at least up until some years ago, there were the McCoys and the Hatfields, two tribes that hated each other and killed each other on sight all year long. But 1 week, one group would come in the one side of a walled city and stack up all their weapons, and the other group would come in the other, and they'd have this wild party for a week, and all the residents would go upstairs, just let them have the town for a week. Then they'd take their weapons and go back to killing each other for the rest of the year. All the weapons they picked up were World War II Italian infantry weapons. That's what those tribes use, and they're in that same region where that regiment disappeared. So the theory is that the Germans proved to us by launching a missile from a submerged submarine and killing that regiment with a neutron bomb. And Jim Mars brings out the fact that he found evidence that he feels he can conclusively prove that German U-boat U-238, interestingly, that's the number of an isotope of uranium, sailed through the North Atlantic underneath the United States Navy into Maine to a port, and offloaded some 550 pounds of enriched uranium and maybe one of those two atomic bombs. If you remember looking at them, they were two totally different bombs. The Fat Boy we built, then there was this one that was just a little small cylinder painted black. Mars thinks that they did deliver one atomic bomb and that they actually detonated one against Russia, and Stalin, in order to quell panic, made the statement that a huge ammunition dump had blown up. Anyway, The Rise of the Fourth Reich by Jim Mars, read the book, it's very interesting. It'll show you some different aspects of history. And I think we need... What the hell was that doing there?
I have no idea who put that there.
I don't either.
Did you get wet?
Yeah, of course I did.
I don't know who put that in. You're next. You're up.
Oh, I'm up.
Brandy.
Thanks.
Did you want to say something?
Well, this is a dangerous place to stand right now.
All the electricity and the water.
I can. I might get electrocuted up here.
Was that because I talked too long?
That's part of it.
Yeah.
It's karma. It's karma. You got
to
get paid back.
Thanks for the program.
Thank you.
Well, I just wanted to say that I appreciate the fact that something like history is important to enough people that we can all keep, the dialogue going about how we read the deeds of man over a period of time. There's a famous quote, those who forget the past are doomed to repeat it. And I don't think there's anything more true of our species than that we continue to repeat the stupidity and the arrogance and so forth of our ancestors over and over and over again.
Because we still have good and bad people, and we still have left and right, and we still have yin and yang, and we still have
right, that's why
we'll
working on this paper on eugenics is interesting, because it's like, can we have a world that's streamlined, and without flaws in it? Can we have human beings without flaws? Well, we can have robots and automatons, but humans have, a tendency to come up with weird ideas and strange irrational behaviors. And, we're governed by not only angels, but by demons, I think. And sometimes those will appear at the most inopportune time. And I think that's why I think we need each other to debate these things and say, well, I read history differently than somebody else. I like to read the people that were victims. When I was studying in the Civil War, I was reading Uncle Tom's Cabin and Tubman's Underground Railroad and Frederick Douglass's Narrative of a Slave. You read these books written by the people that were victims, just like I read about the people in concentration camps, the survivors, Elie Wiesel, people like that. And it's a real lesson in humility of how little we really know, because we don't have God's eye view. We think we do sometimes. We think we know the answer. We're convinced that we know the answer to something. But I think at best we just know the approximation of something. So anyway, I appreciate y'all thinking about the stuff. I had a variety of things that I pulled in because they seemed to relate to, you know, the world that I wanted to create a kind of a configuration. So I pulled in some stuff from Hitler and the Civil War and scripture and history and stuff like that, because it's I find it to be just fascinating that when you start thinking about this stuff or reading about it, it just goes all over the place. And when you go to talk about it, I don't have a prepared manuscript that I read. I had one, but seems boring to me when teachers get up and read their lessons, you know? So I have a hard time doing that. I'd rather just think about the things that I've been reading about and writing about and see where it goes from there. So thank you for your indulgence.
Except for you. Well, you weren't indulgent at all.
Anyway, that's it for tonight. Our speaker, they'll kick us out of here by 10:30, so our speaker is here. You can talk to him, whatever we want to do. See you all next week.
I'm sorry, I missed it.
Years ago, I was talking about Gnosticism.
I was going to say that.
The city of
Dallas.
Million
and
a
million.